I got to say I'm incredibly, incredibly impressed with all of the listeners that have been tuned in. I just got an email here from someone that has been listening from the start. This is at 8 p.m. yesterday, started listening to the program and has been with us throughout. Has not slept. Has been watching on the vidcast system. Which you can find on our website at thebadlandsradio.com. Just click on enter site and you'll go in. You'll see the little video window, the live stream. You can click on that and make it nice and big. And But they've been with us from the very start. And there's about three or four of them. They're making an event out of it. Wow, you guys are brave. I'm telling you. You are. I was just checking on Jimmy and Celine here, making sure they're okay. Jimmy wasn't looking too good at his desk. Celine said she was fine. She's doing good. So we don't really have that much longer to go. Let's see. 2, 4, 6. About 8 more hours. It's not bad, right? Cliff High joins me from Half Past Human. And just before the break, we were talking about this amount of data sets that show that they're, you know, we were talking about the collapse of the dollar. And he said that many, many people will die at that point, and all paper currencies eventually die. My question I'm going to propose to him now is the amount of severity which he thinks in the cities. How bad will it be in the cities compared to out here like me in the middle of nowhere? Which would be worse? I would think that, of course, obviously it would be the cities, but maybe not. We don't know. Cliff, what do you say?
Well, initially I would think that would be the case. I mean, this is just monkey mind speculation. We do not have any data that suggests that the cities are going to be hit any harder than the rest of the country, because bear in mind, for instance, that rural and agricultural areas are 100% dependent upon farm financing for the local money flow.
Yes.
And farm financing at best is a con in which the farmers are made to work for a mere pittance and get in hock for the next crop and all of that, and at its worst, it's, you know, it's a terrible Ponzi scheme where people eventually accrue the farmer's assets through this incredible amount of debt.
Right.
So that will collapse. The ability for the farmers to be able to maintain the monoculture system we have now will collapse. Mm-hmm. So the rural areas are going to be hit extremely hard. What good is a $350,000 or more dollar combine if you can't get a loan to buy the seed and you're used to dealing with things on a diesel economy?
Yes.
And you can't afford the diesel anymore because suddenly the cost of a diesel fuel is, you know, $100 a gallon for diesel.
Yes.
It wouldn't be that sudden. It'd be quite gradual to ramp up there, but nonetheless, once the petrodollar is fully dead, then we will have to pony up, by we, I mean people in the United States, will have to pony up something of real value to buy the euro currency or the Gulf States currency in order to buy oil.
Mm-hmm.
What will we offer the world as value for the money that we're going to have to use to buy the oil? People are, you know, in the rest of the world, they're not going to want to take dollars or greenbacks or treasuries or derivatives or any of this kind of stuff.
Right.
So we're going to be in a world of hurt that will be shockingly deep and also quite rapid. The cities versus the rural areas, I think it's going to be not as anybody might anticipate, because a lot of the stuff we have about the cities seems to indicate that there will be magnets and that they'll actually start drawing people from the crumbling suburbs.
Hmm. You know, there is this strange thing going on where they're doing an attack on things like backyard farmers. They have their own gardens and things like this. They're proposing legislation to put tighter restrictions on that. I mean, to the point of where the farmers markets are being targeted as well. And we may not see farmers markets here in the near future if they get their way, that is. But, and then with the hoarding of seeds by a company like companies like Monsanto that genetically modify everything, and they just own it. They've bullied and taken away seeds. They see these things as their property. There is a target on food itself as being owned as property, almost like copywritten property that no one can trade or no one can grow without permission.
That's very much part of the whole control mechanism thing. And you see these moves by the powers that be, you see these screwy-ass laws that they propose, and then I always stop and say, okay, how would they enforce it? Nope, nope, not going to happen, especially in the chaos that's upcoming, and they're anticipating an orderly transition of a sense where they maintain power. And I would maintain that already the GMO seed hoarding has failed, because there's a huge underground movement, and it's not even all that underground, it's out in the open. Go and look at Seed Exchange,
yes,
Seed Trade, or any of these places on the internet. Hundreds of thousands of transactions of people trading seeds and saving seeds and storing and doing their own genetic modification in the sense of growing different crops based on hybridizing.
Yes.
And so that's already occurred. There's probably more traffic now as a result of the internet in seed exchanges than has ever existed before, and there's probably more exotic seeds in stranger places than has ever existed before. So this is probably a very good trend.
Yes.
And it's also the same kind of trend towards an underground, or, if you will, a black market economy away from the powers that be's banking system. And we've seen that grow. And it, consistently, the government always acknowledges about a 9 to 10% underground gray or black economy. And I would have to say that their numbers are consistently lies, and that somewhere probably in Italy, it's estimated to be 70% of all transactions go unreported and untaxed. And I think in the United States, you could easily think that the progression has gone to over 20% and maybe as high as 30%. And it'll grow. And so, yeah, there's the whole powers that be, and they want to lay all these things on you. But as Che Guevara noted, you know, oppression by the powers that be, it creates an instant and an opposite reaction in the sense of creating revolutionary fervor in the populace. And that revolutionary fervor is popping out in the form of guerrilla gardening. You've seen all of these.
Yes.
People running around with these seed bombs.
Yes.
Are you familiar with that?
Yes. Yes, indeed. Yeah. I'm thinking that the backyard gardeners eventually are going to play an enormous role here in what very well could happen in the very near future if this happens. But it's still a little worrisome for me.
As it should be. We don't have an organized food system on the planet, and we're also facing a climate catastrophe, and since the year 2000 we've had a net loss each and every year in grains. This is not good. Last year was the last year we could have afforded a net loss without dipping into stores. Now we've had to dip into our grain stores, and they're still using grains for biofuels, and we need to eat those.
Yes.
So this is why we're predicting, and also why our math has come out to about 1.25 billion people will die of starvation, the ancillary effects of starvation, and as well as the breakdown of the healthcare system as a direct result of the dollar. And we're seeing that already, in the sense that it's been estimated that 10 million people have starved to death since the food riots of last year, all due to the 30% loss in purchasing power of the dollar. And I would also argue that 30% is just government hocus pocus, and in many cases, especially in food and fuel, in other parts of the planet where they were dollar dependent, it's been much greater, and it'll soon come to us.
Oh my! Now we have we have about 15 minutes left here, and we have three different categories to get to. I'm going to let you tell me which one we should cover first. The last one, I think, was my favorite, because it's Space Goat Farts, MIB at Dread U, Woo Woo, Floats, Shadows, Play, Moving Day.
Yeah, I love the Space Goat Farts. That's where we throw all of our... we should really go to there. That's where we throw all of our unknown and officially denied kind of stuff, and we get really weird data sets in there that frequently turn out to be quite right. And in this case, we've got some the data sets that seem to suggest that the Men in Black, which we're just using as a euphemism for those people that would enforce some UFO kind of censure and ridicule and that sort of thing, right?
Mm-hmm.
Something that might be detailed in Dolan's book on UFOs and the national security state. Those guys, which we're calling our Men in Black fellows, are going to run into a curious situation here this coming year, where they're going to run smack into the woo-woo world and, in essence, be overcome. And it's going to just be really interesting to see how it actually plays out. But we think that there's going to be a Rastafarian, to put it gently, or perhaps more adequately, somebody of a Jamaican appearance and or extraction that will be the lead force in on this. A lot of it's going to be just to the point of ridicule, because this personality is going to be basically pointing out all of the flaws in their logic and everything as we go forward on this, as the UFO kind of stuff is landing around their ears.
Yes.
We suspect a big secrets outpouring as the dollar dies. Again, everything is connected. As the dollar dies, all these subcontractors are going to be let go from the federal government as it starts going through what we're calling coagulation or contraction.
Yes. Yes.
And once that happens, these poor guys that are used to making X number of dollars will be thrown on the trash heap and won't have any income at all, because by then, unemployment will be a joke, food stamps won't work anymore, etc.
Right.
And so these guys will start figuring out, oh, hey, I know some really interesting stuff that maybe somebody might pay me to come on out and talk about.
Mm-hmm.
And when they start doing that, the secrets start rolling out, and it starts getting really difficult for the men in black to come and push all these things back into the box.
You know, it's interesting, too, that you say that, because at some point here during the broadcast, I was highlighting the government jobs over $100,000 that have been created and over the past three to four years. And, no, actually, it was just over the past year. They are incredibly high now. There are so many jobs that have been created with $100,000 or more salaries, where it's leaving people scratching their heads like, wow, well, this is an incredible jump in the federal government for employment, for everything you can imagine. And that just means...